Well, good morning. How's everybody doing? Was that some powerful worship or what? My goodness, I felt the Holy Spirit in the house. If you do have any room around you and you can scooch in, please do so. We are packed full this morning, and we got all the chairs we can get in here. So I'm excited about our speaker this morning, but I wanted to share two little things with you before. I got two little visual pictures, and how many... Cooked a turkey this week. Anybody cook a turkey this week? Yeah. How many of you fried a turkey? This is what I saw in the spirit. You know how you put the turkey in the grease and you got to do it real slowly, but that stuff just starts bubbling up? I just felt by the spirit that's what's happening right now, is that, you know, your goose is about to get cooked. You know what I mean? I feel like you don't even know what's about to happen. It's fixing it. But listen, you're being slowly lowered right now into the holy presence, the oil of God right now. And I'm telling you, there's about to be a beautiful fragrance released, and something's going to get cooked in you that needs to be cooked out of you. You know what I mean? The other one I got, though, is this, and this is weird. You guys ever see the video of the two dogs that are just like, there's a fence in between them, and they're just going at it, man. They're just, and they're going to tear each other apart. And then the fence opens, and they go, like they don't see each other. And then they close the fence again, and they're, I just feel like, listen, don't be those dogs, okay? The gate's about to be opened. You guys are ready. I mean, there's something on the inside of you is stirring. You're stirred up this morning by the Spirit. And when that gate fully opens, don't go, No, you know what? You bite the devil's head off this morning. Amen? You let the Holy Spirit do whatever he wants to do. Don't stop the flow this morning. That's what I want to say to you. Don't stop the flow because you're like, oh, I've never seen that before. I don't understand that. Listen, you trust the Holy Spirit this morning. Let the Holy Spirit do what only the Holy Spirit can do. Amen? And I am so honored to be able to introduce our speaker to you today. I said it in the first service, but he's more like family to us. I remember, I think the first time he came was when I was 4 or 5 years old, and he comes every year. So for almost 40 years, he's been coming, and every year, like Pastor Wayne said, he delivers a life-changing word. I am living today off of prophetic words that were spoken over myself and my wife. My son right here in the front row was prophesied and prayed over through Brother Ivan Tait 20 years ago. He said, we were not able to have children. You've probably already heard this, but if you haven't, I'll tell it real quick. Not able to have children. He prayed over myself and my wife, and he prophesied, by the time I come next year, you'll be holding a child. And we were holding our son, Aubrey. He's 20 years old. So I just want to tell you, like, you're stirred up. You know something's happening right now in the spirit. You can feel the undercurrents of the presence of God in this place. Listen, would you just please let that continue? And would you please give my friend and family member, Ivan Tait, a warm welcome this morning. Amen.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Good morning, everybody. We are in Burleson, Texas, and God is good. This morning, we're going to show you a video of the orphanage we have in Guatemala. As Monday night and Tuesday night, we'll show you Africa things. Also, we have some beautiful sponsor cards for those of you that want to get involved in rescuing orphans with us. These are Africa. And then we have our Guatemala. We're up to 200 kids in Guatemala and about 1,500 in Africa. So if you guys believe it's your job to rescue orphans, take care of widows, feed the poor, I'm a good place to do that with because I will invite you. We do trips every month so you can actually come and meet the kids for yourself. You'll be seeing a video here of Guatemala. This is an update, and then in just a moment, we'll begin to minister to you. Today is going to be a life-changing day. Would you tell the person next to you, just look at him and say, I have something to tell you. You're going to lose 25 pounds this morning, and that will be a sign and a wonder. Hallelujah. Stretch your hands out to him. Say, I shrink the turkey. I shrink the pecan pie. I shrink the pumpkin pie. I shrink.
Thank you for ration. Thank you for rain. Thank you for joy. Thank you for pain. It's a beautiful day. Yeah, 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 yeah. It's a beautiful day.
Greetings from Casa Angelina. We are so excited that halfway through the year, we have so many testimonies to share with you. We have been undergoing a huge clinic expansion, and we're happy to say that the new equipment that we ordered has all arrived. With this equipment, we will be able to better meet the needs of all the children who live at Casa Angelina. Additionally, the services we offer the surrounding communities will now be able to expand. One of the projects we have been so excited about at Casa Angelina has been the completion of the road that goes from the main gate of Casa Angelina all the way through and around the property. With this road being completed, we will be able to have an incredible space for the children to play on no matter the weather. We are currently undergoing the construction of our multi-purpose sports courts. This area is going to be for basketball, volleyball, and pickleball, and we are very excited about reaching the completion of this project. The Creative House is now open and filled with college-age girls who are studying in university and pursuing careers for their future. Additionally, we are so excited that we have been able to begin the Boys University Home. We thank God continually for the opportunity to raise young men in this country who will go to change the nation. For many years now, we have been seeking the purchase of a new plot of land in addition to Casa Angelina. After many years, we have been able to purchase this piece of land, and we give glory to God for this new opportunity we have. Our avocado tree farm is growing. We currently are doing a nutrition bath on all of the trees, something that we have to do semi-annually. The teams have been coming back this year to Casa Angelina. We are extremely grateful for every person who has come down to visit us again here in Guatemala. As many know, our Widows program has been growing exponentially over the years. We currently are in construction on 3 new Widows homes. The celebrations at Easter are epic in Casa Angelina. We love being able to celebrate what Jesus has done for each and every one of us. The school at Casa Angelina has gone through incredible changes in 2023. By placing a higher emphasis on learning English, we have seen a great advancement in our children this year. Because of the status of our school, we were invited to participate with all of our high school students in different soccer competitions. And we came out victorious and now are headed to the championship round in July. Every year we have generous donors and supporters who help us take all of our youth to a huge Christian youth concert. And many experience beautiful promises that the Lord speaks to them. Our children have an incredible time during these 3 days. We want you to know that we pray continued blessings on you, your family, your home, your businesses, and that the children of Casa Angelina are praying for you. We love you and we bless you. Thank you for partnering with us.
Congratulations. Hallelujah. Thank you. Appreciate that. Very quickly, you can go to Proverbs 10:22 As you're doing that, let me mention that one of the important things you want to do is continue to get educated as a Christian. There are many levels to Christianity. It's like starting in first grade. You have to go through high school, then you have to go through college, then you have to go through graduate school. So you start out as a child, then you become a young adult, then you become a father or a mother. So it's a journey. If you do not fill yourself with revelation, then you're going to grow weaker because the world is constantly feeding you information that resists the wonder working power of the Holy Spirit. Because you're educated by the world through TV and other books that are not anointed by the Holy Spirit, you come in conflict within yourself with the miracle working powers of the Holy Spirit. You then become a saved and useless believer. You're saved intellectually, but you're lost experientially. So your experiences are like the experiences of unsaved people, even though your thinking is the thinking of someone who believes in God. If you can't get out of this cycle, it will be passed on to your children. The signs that this cycle or this culture has invaded your family is nobody reads the Bible in the house. Nobody worships and sings to God. Nobody gets people saved out on the streets. And no one prays for the sick in public places. We become very useless as we have a spirit of entitlement that we as Christians in some way are supposed to feel superior to lost people, which is the exact fruit of religious thinking. This is the opposite that you're supposed to think. You and I, our highest level of promotion is foot washer. That is as high as you get to go. If you wash the feet of people, then you are gloriously anointed in heaven. The greatest in the kingdom is the servant of all. Hallelujah. Turn to someone around you, look at them, and say, I have a word for you. Look at them and say these words. You. I'm going to pay off my house on Monday. The Lord has spoken. So be it. Holla, holla. Give someone a high five and say you're about to get saved. We are having revival this week at Burleson, Monday night and Tuesday night. If you are outside of the hungers of God, you will stay home and watch football. This will be what you really want to do. But if you are in a place of hunger and you say, I need more of God in my family, my marriage needs more of Jesus, I need more of God in my private walk with God. If, for example, you're addicted to pornography, I would suggest you show up. If you hate your husband, this would be a good time to come to church. If you regularly throw the finger at people, this would be a good time to come back to church. If you're getting drunk, if you're high on reefers right now, you're in the right place at the right time. Hallelujah. Go ahead and hug that person next to you. And say these words to him. I need you to pay me the money you owe me. Because I don't know what this preacher is talking about. He lost me at hello. Wave your hands. Look at someone and say, you need help. So though you may think you're saved, and you probably are, you may have the title of a Christian, but the lifestyle of a lost person. So when we have revival, this is a time where everything changes for you, where your rudder gets fixed your compass is repaired, and your eyes get healed, and your ears get healed, and your heart is reshaped. All information shapes your heart. All information, whatever you're taking in from whatever source, is shaping your heart. So you want the Holy Spirit to shape you. You want the Holy Spirit to shape your heart. You want to have the heart of Jesus, because Christianity doesn't work if you only have an idea of God that you believe in. You've got to have the lifestyle of Christ likeness, and this produces the fruit that is sweet to your taste. Hallelujah. Give another hug to the person next to you and say, this is more hugging than we've done in 35 years. What is the deal with all this hugging? We are starting this morning, and as I was saying in the first service, and I want to say to you, you should be real, real serious about what's going on right now. We are in war. We are in a time of war all over the world. Not just physical war, but spiritual war. Satan is walking around the United States naked and calling himself Satan and inviting everybody to follow him. He's not even changing his name anymore. He's just coming at your children straight ahead. He's coming at you straight ahead. He wants to get every family divorced. He wants all children to be abandoned and orphans. He wants everybody to become a pervert in some way. He wants you to get addicted to something that will kill you as soon as possible. He wants you to hate people so your cancer will grow on the inside of you. He wants you to not be able to forgive so that you become sick mentally. He wants to steal your sleep, steal your peace, so that you'll get on drugs and then be addicted to drugs and not be able to sleep without them. He wants you to hate church, hate preachers, and never read your Bible. He wants you to stop praying in the Holy Spirit or praying at home as a couple. He wants you to sleep in different rooms, never talk to each other, and stop having holla holla. Turn to two people and say, oh, Jesus. Your hair is not falling out by accident. Some of you, of course, you have the gift of falling out hair. Look around. Look at all the bald people. Go ahead. Do you know that baldness is the highest level of anointing? Do you know that a bald person has so much of Jesus in their brain that the hair cannot stay on their head because of the divine thoughts that they are having that blows the hair right out of their head? So look at them and touch them and say, can I just touch you? Then, of course, white hair is the second level. Look at all the white-haired people. And that's wise. That's wisdom people right there. Now, those of you that dyed your hair, you don't count. But for the rest of us. So we're going on a journey. This morning we're beginning because Pastor Cody asked me if I would minister in line with what has been ministered to this month on the blessings of the Lord. And specifically how to release the blessings of God. So let's begin in the book of Proverbs, chapter 10, and verse 22. Out in the foyer, you will find life-changing books, Untouchable, The 13 Ways Satan Wants to Destroy Your Life and How to Stop Him. Letters from God for Children. This will connect you as a parent back to your children. You will learn 52 character traits. You will practice that for 1 week. Learn one Bible verse on forgiveness, for example. And you will memorize that Bible verse with your children for that week. Then there will be 7 questions about forgiveness. You will begin on Monday on what is forgiveness. And you, as a non-lazy parent, will teach your children what forgiveness is based on what their age is. For example, So every day for the 7 days, you'll practice forgiveness with your children and have this connection with them. Whoever bonds with your children mentors them. Some of you are not actually raising your children. You're just housing them. They are being raised by their best friends because that's where their emotional bonding is. So their friends become their teachers. And they are learning things that are opposite of what you want them to learn, but because you sometimes get lazy and you refuse to take time with your children in the Word of God, they are then close to their friends who take all day with them and teach them the ways of hell. Didn't feel the love on that, so I'm going to go over here and encourage myself. Praise God, Brother Ivan. That was awesome. Glory to Jesus, my brother. So you have 365 things your children should know before they leave your house. You have the prophetic parent, how to prophesy over your children and get them under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. The lovable you, and that's basically how to stop being a mean person. Turn to two people and say, you need that book right there. I'm gonna buy that book for you. Yeah. Then you have letters from God, the journal, 365 letters. If God wrote you a letter every day for a year, what would he say? Just look up your birthday. I think that'll change your life. And we have Woman Defined. This is how to get rid of all the people you don't like out of your life without killing them. Woman Defined. Praise the Lord. So now what we're going to learn is how to release God's blessing. First of all, let me show you what God's blessing is in a quick way. Here are some of the things. Proverbs 10:22. The blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. The way you know that you have a blessing on you is you are rich in that area, and you have no grief attached to that area. For example, the way you know your marriage is blessed is your marriage is full of fruit. It is rich. Your wife and you have learned the secret of a happy marriage, which is not to depend on each other for happiness. What did you say? If you look to your husband to make you happy, you are going to be disappointed because he is nuts. If you look to your wife to make you happy, you're going to be disappointed because she is crazy. Look at each other and say, "This, what a sermon. I'm crazy, he's nuts, my God." The secret is for you to not need your husband to love you in order to be happy. If you get your happiness from Jesus and you are fully satisfied by him, whatever love your wife or your husband gives you is icing on the cake. The only way you can possibly love a person unconditionally is to not need them to behave a particular way. As long as your happiness depends on how they behave, you will be unhappy till the day you die. If Jesus is not enough, you don't have the right Jesus. Think about how many days you've spent crying and in depression because of your husband's behavior. He hasn't changed in 25 years. The toilet lid is still wet. He had gas in the car on the way here, right in front of you. He didn't stop the car. He didn't stop, say, "I got to get out, glory Jesus," and come back in. He didn't do that. He just said, sorry, and you're drowning and dying. And, of course, ladies are different. They're stealth bombers. They do not make noise. They just kill everything in the car. No noise whatsoever. You may not like this kind of preaching. Maybe a little bit too real, too gross, and too personal. But please understand, by the time we're done on Tuesday, you will have the blessings on your head. Turn to somebody and say, "I need some blessings." tell the person behind, I don't know about you, but I need some blessings. I need blessings to chase me down. I need blessings to pursue me. I need blessings to be waiting for me early in the morning. I need blessings when I go to sleep. I need blessings during my sleep, and I need blessings when I wake up. Look at somebody and say, I need blessings on my right hip. I need blessings on my left hip. I need blessings in the middle of my back, and I need blessings on my head. I need blessings in my teeth. I need blessings in my ear. I need blessings on every part of my body. And those of you that don't, lay hands on those that are around you that are going, please, on the left elbow there. Blessings, you want to have them. Some of you don't know that you're actually under a curse right now. You don't know it because your theology refuses to allow you to believe that. But the fruit is the only reliable judge. Not language, fruit. Fruit. That's how you tell what's true. The fruit. Hallelujah. If you and your wife are arguing and threatening divorce all the time, you're not under a blessing. That's a curse. It's you're repeating what Satan wants you to say. Because the curse is tangibly on you, and you can feel it coming out of your mouth. What we want to do this week is remove all curses, bring all blessings, and start living a life of divine encounters with God. There are 10 encounters you've got to have in this lifetime to fulfill your destiny and be happy. We're going to do 5 on Monday and 5 on Tuesday. Turn to 2 people and say, I need to have an encounter with God. Not with religion. Not with religion. Not with religion. You see, if you're not in the life of Christianity, these are some of the signs. 1, you don't bring a Bible to church. That's the first sign. You don't bring it, and you don't write down anything because you're telling God, I'm not expecting you to change my life. I just want to make sure my ticket is verified, so if I happen to die, I'll go to heaven. Because if you're serious about walking with God, as you are with your job, you have to remember the information that makes you successful in your job. So it is with Christianity. You have to remember what God specifically tells you. If you only remember 2 things from every sermon, in 1 year you will have 100 things that you can point to and say, these are the 100 things God spoke to me this year. They were personal, they were directed at me, and they were for me, and I am never going to forget them, because the only thing that has the power to keep changing you is what you remember. If you don't even bring a Bible, don't feel condemned. I'm not trying to condemn you, but please get convicted. You have no hope without the Word of God. You can't make it in your marriage without Jesus in the middle of it, because some of you are not compatible without Jesus. Only Jesus, the third person in your marriage, keeps your marriage together. And if you don't have him, it's going to blow up. Your husband's going to get 2 or 3 other women to fulfill his other crazy stuff. Your wife's going to do the same. Your children are going to get on reefers. They're going to have all kinds of moral dilemmas. We need to be blessed. Tangible blessings. Hallelujah. Would you look at your neighbor and says, be blessed. Say these words to them. I break every curse over you. Say it to everybody around you. Say, I break every curse over your life. Curses that you got from your mama, I break them. Say it. Curses that you got from your daddy, say it. I break them. Curses that you got from disobeying God. Curses that you got by living in the darkness instead of the light. Curses that you got by not forgiving certain people. Curses that you have by chasing sin in your life. Curses that have come because you have kissed sin. the darkness and refused to chase it away. Hallelujah. Hate is how you make Satan your pastor. And that is an ushering in of a curse. And there are plenty of people to hate because we are in a time of war. If you're in war, you can't act like it's a time of peace. This is not the time to watch TV. This is the time to get on your knees and intercede and cry out to God and call on the name of the Lord for your sons and daughters and grandchildren. This is a time to say, you cannot have my children. You cannot have my grandchildren. You cannot make them atheists. You cannot make them agnostics. You cannot make them perverts. You cannot make them ungodly. This is not my family. And you have to go to war and act like you're a soldier instead of acting like you've already lost the war and just give up everything in your house and let everybody come in there and just steal everything. If you are attacked, you must fight back. Hallelujah. You can't just let people break in your house and kill everybody. What kind of a man does that? What kind of a woman does that? If a lion comes in the room and your little grandchild is in front of you, you're not going to throw your grandchild at the lion. You're going to tell your grandchild, run away, and you'll run at the lion and jump in its mouth and let it chew on you while your grandchild escapes. Hallelujah. Look at someone and say, I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm about to get blessed. Here are some of the blessings of the Lord. It makes rich and never adds sorrow. Provision, say, that's for me. Favor, say, that's for me. Protection, say, that's for me. Joy, say, that's for me. Wisdom, say, that's for me. Health, say, that's for me. Success, say, that's for me. Fruitfulness, say, that's for me. Keep saying that. Fruitfulness, fruitfulness, fruitfulness. Guidance, say, that's for me. Protection from harm from myself, say, that's for me. Peace of mind, say, that's for me. Contentment in all circumstances, say, that's for me. All of the restoration, say, that's for me. Glory to Jesus. Open doors of opportunity. Everybody say it. That is for me. Knowing God intimately, that is for me. So how do you release the blessings of the Lord? Let me give you some of the ways so that everybody can understand that you want to carry on you a tangible blessing that other people can feel. You don't want a house full of depression. You want a house full of joy. You don't want to have to take drugs to go to sleep. You want to have the blessing of the Lord on your sleep when you go to bed. No fear and no anxiety. You want to be able to say, I'm on no drugs of any kind. I have no stress because I'm under the blessing of the Lord that makes rich. I have the peace of God that passes understanding. I have success and favor in all areas of my life, and I have divine health from the Holy Spirit. Turn to somebody and say, that's what I want. Tell them, tell people next. I have children that are saved, grandchildren that are born again. All of them have a calling and an anointing on their life. And if you don't have it, it's because you don't have the blessing. And what God wants to do is put the blessing on every aspect of your life. Hallelujah. So the blessing of the Lord. First, Mark 16, verses 17 through 22. And these signs shall follow them that believe. You shall cast out devils. You shall heal the sick. You shall speak with new languages. You shall, all of these blessings are listed by believing. The first step that you need to do to get blessings coming towards you and to release blessings out of you to others is you must believe in the power of God's living word. Satan's job is to persuade you that the Bible was not written by God, to make you an unbeliever in church, and to make you believe that there's nothing supernatural about the Bible that can give you supernatural inheritances and substance. But the word of God is the living power of God. My delight is in the word of God. I shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. I will bring forth my fruit in my season, and my leaf shall not wither. Satan's job is to get the Bible out of your hands. If you want blessings, they're going to come by believing the word of God. And as you believe the word of God, the blessings begin to flow. And as you fill yourself with the Bible by memorizing what God tells you from that Bible, you redefine your insides and become a new person, totally different than the person you are right now. So turn to somebody and say, I believe that God wrote the Bible, that it is inspired by God. It is from everlasting to everlasting, that God honors his word even above his name. Can you praise him a little bit? Take a little praise break right now and say, thank you, God, for the Bible. And now repent. Repent for not bringing a Bible. Repent. Repent for it right now. If you're repenting, stand up. Just stand up right now and say, I'm going to repent. I'm repenting for not bringing a Bible, and I'm going to start bringing it. Go ahead, do it. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Oh, don't sit back down. No. No, this has got to be in front of everybody. We don't repent in private only. We repent in public, especially for not having the word of God. Nothing wrong with you whatsoever. But remember that your blessings come from humility. Humility is when you say, I did something wrong. I'm going to fix it right now. Bam. And at that moment, the blessings begin to flow in your. Look at all the people that are standing, and that's only half of the ones that should be standing. So, well, I don't know if I like this kind of preaching. You're kind of putting us on the spot. Exactly. Exactly. It's called Bible preaching. My job is not to make you like me. My job is to bring you into an encounter with God. That's my job. You're standing up because you're saying, I'm never going to let the devil steal from me again by not bringing my Bible to church and writing down what God says about me. So come on, the rest of you, go ahead and stand up, because there's a bunch more of you that need to get this in your heart and say, hey, I'm bringing a Bible from now on. Glory to Jesus. I'm bringing it on my phone, or I'm bringing it in my hand, but I'm going to start writing down what God says. How can we have a revival if nobody wants to repent? That would mean you don't need to repent, and I shouldn't be up here. You should be up here. Amen. So I receive that before the Lord, and he receives that. You are totally cleansed and forgiven. Heal yourself with the word of God. Bring it every time you come to church, and get ready to write down what God tells you. Just two things out of every message. Wait. Don't write everything. Just wait, wait, wait. It'll explode inside. You'll say, ooh, that was from God. And your world will be different. By next week, your world will change just because you believe and the blessings begin to flow to you. Hallelujah. Instead of away from you, because that's what doubt and unbelief do. So say it, I'm getting rich right now in Jesus' name. Don't sit down. Now we have the third wave. The third wave. Some more of you need to repent. Come on, go ahead and stand up. You know who you are. Say, I'm going to start bringing the Bible from now on. Come on. Say, well, this is really confrontational. Of course it is. I've been doing this for 50 years. It's not my job to tickle your ears. Why won't you repent for not bringing the Bible? It's called pride. Unless you know it all. Do you know the whole entire Bible? Say, oh, Ivan, man, can you feel the stress and strain? Yeah, of course. Of course, I do this every week. Yeah, we're cutting through the cords of darkness because Satan wants to steal the Bible from you. He doesn't want you to believe in the Bible. He doesn't want you to go to the Bible for your answers, for your healing, for your blessing, for your marriage, for your children, for your business. He wants you to stay away from the greatest book ever written that can bless you and put blessings on every aspect of your life. Praise God. All right, one more chance. Anybody else? I'm going to count to three, and then we're done. One, two, three. God bless you. You may be seated. Let's keep going. Turn to seven people and say, wow, man, that made me sweat. You may think that it's good to go somewhere where you're comfortable, but ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you are mistaken. People making you feel comfortable when you're being destroyed, it's not love. It's like your children, if they're smoking weed, you don't say, I love you so much. Could I see that reefer? Wow, that's a cool looking reefer. Here you go. No, you wouldn't do that. If they have a snake in bed with them, a poisonous one, you wouldn't say, oh, is that a rattler? Oh, my. Real interesting. I love you. And then walk away. No. You get a sword and cut the head of the snake off. Cut the head of the snake off. Because you don't want the snake to bite your children. And that's what technology does. Yeah, they're learning to shoot people, kill people, violate people. They know more cuss words than regular words. Revival, ladies and gentlemen, is a time to get serious with God. And you may say after today, I don't think I'll go back because that was a little scary. Brother Ivan's crazy. I'm sorry. I have to stand before God. I have to do things in love, but I have to do things. Right? I want you to be healthier by Tuesday. And I want blessings chasing you down the street instead of the curses of hell. Go ahead and hug each other. Look at your person and say, listen, I'll take $100 if that's all you can afford. Give me $100 down payment on what you owe me. Now, you can hate me if you want, but you're just acting like a baby. Because what do babies do? Whenever you correct them, they throw a fit. But remember what Proverbs 12:1 says. Only a stupid man refuses to be corrected. God saves you by correcting you for the things that can hurt you. That's an important thing to learn when you're walking with God. See, smart people learn from every individual they meet. Stupid people only learn from people they think are smarter than they are. We learn from every person because every person has a truth they want to teach us, whether they know it or not. Glory to God. Look at two people and say, I'm going to get blessed this week. Say, I'm going to have blessings chase me everywhere I go. Say, my business is going to double and triple and quadruple. Say it out loud. My marriage is going to get healed. My husband is going to love me. I'm going to love my wife. My wife is going to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. Say all my children will be delivered from Satan's plans for their life. My children shall not be destroyed by drugs or alcohol or any type of destructive idea or thought or force. Because the blessing of the Lord is going to be in my life, and I am going to get blessed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's keep going with the things that release the blessings of the Lord. Number two, Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 12. If you will obey the voice of the Lord your God, all these blessings will pursue you and chase you. So the second key that releases blessings into your home, family, business, life, body, soul, spirit, mind, emotions, everything, is obeying what God tells you. If you refuse to obey God, that is how you invite curses to minister to you. If you obey God, that's how you embrace the blessings of the Lord. And the most important type of obedience is obeying when you don't want to. Because that is called true worship. When you obey and you don't want to obey, that's true worship. And that releases God's biggest blessings. 3, Malachi 3:10. Tithing releases the blessings of God on you financially, spiritually, and emotionally. Because God will rebuke the devourer from you. Listen to my words. God does not want you to tithe because he needs your money. He wants you to tithe so you won't need your money. Because the only way God can give you money is if you'll do with it what he tells you. But if you need the money, then God cannot trust you to obey him with his money. So you want to be free from needing money. And the way you get free from that is by sowing money to anybody that is an orphan, a widow, a poor person, your church, or your parents. If you want to get financially blessed and have a blessing, a financial blessing, give money to your parents. Don't borrow it. And if you are a good parent, train your children from little children to tithe to you. Instead of to borrow from you. Because you're just creating a welfare system that's called you. They're going to borrow money from you and then never pay you back. But that's not how you raise children. One of my children walks up to me, her and her husband, they say, hey, we want to give you a blessing, $50,000. Turn to two people and say, I believe what this man's preaching right now. I believe that's the Holy Spirit right now. I believe that's the Lord. I believe that's the way to raise children. Praise God. I'm going to start raising them now, even though they're not in my house. By the way, I heard a sermon today. The Lord wants you to hear this sermon. It's really an amazing sermon. You're supposed to tithe to me right now. Well, I'm adding it up since you were born till today. You owe me $175,000, and I'd like that today so you'll be blessed and live a long life. Otherwise, you're going to drop dead. Little witchcraft. You're not blessing your children by making them dependent. You're only blessing your children when you set them free and say, my dependence is on the Lord. He blesses me. I bless my parents. And if you hate your parents and sow to them like Joyce Myers did to a man that molested her 250 times, and he built that wicked, evil man a house and paid for it herself. This is national TV, paid for it herself. That man walks into her house one day, throws himself on the floor, and says, if you can forgive me, then God can forgive me. And he got saved right there in the kitchen of her house. Because if you bless wicked parents, you're bringing a blessing on yourself that Satan can never, ever stop. And it will go into the lives of your children. As long as you hate people, you stop the blessing from coming. Obedience is the key that unlocks all the blessings of heaven. Turn to two people and say, he's talking to you. Go ahead and tell that to somebody. Let's go to the next key. Very important on the blessings of the Lord. And on the importance of these wonderful and amazing blessings. Ezekiel, in Ezekiel 37, he saw a valley full of dry bones, dead, worthless, useless, gone. And the Lord said, prophesy to the bones and tell them to live. And he began to prophesy to the dead bones. And the word of the Lord came unto him, just like it will come to you when you're praying for your children and your family. And you start speaking to your unbelieving children who have become atheists, who have become other things, and you start speaking to them, you are a dry bone, but you're going to be changed. I prophesy over you that you will become part of the army of God, and that beginning today, the sinews and the cartilage and the muscles of faith and believing in God will come back into you, and the whole family will start coming back. We had over 1,000 people saved last couple of weeks because people brought entire family members that were not saved. Everybody, the whole entire family got saved. Family after family after family because of prophesying over their family, their unsaved fathers, their unsaved mothers, their unsaved brothers and sisters, their unsaved children, their unsaved parents. You have to speak the word of the Lord over your life and family, and this will release the blessing of the Lord. Look at what Peter did in the book of Acts. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. The name of Jesus is your weapon. You have to use that name and say, in the name of Jesus, my children are coming back to God. In the name of Jesus, my daddy's going to get saved before he died. In the name of Jesus, my sisters and my uncles and my brother are going to get born again and love God and serve God and walk with God. Because Jesus has been given a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every tongue must confess and every knee must bow. Every tongue, whether they do it on this side or that side, everybody's bowing. But demons bow now. Circumstances bow now. Hearts bow now. Praise God. Give somebody a high five and say, I'm going to be a preacher. Turn to two people and say, snap out of it. We find in Mark 12, 41 through 44, another way to release blessings is with unusual generosity. The widow found a prophet, or the prophet found her in a time of famine. Everybody's dropping dead from starvation. And the prophet says to the widow, you got any food? She said, I got one meal left. 1 Kings 17, I got one meal left. I'm going to cook it. My son's going to eat a little tiny bit. I'm going to eat a little tiny bit. Then I'm going to drop dead. He said, don't do that. Make me a pancake. And she did. She said, here's the food. And when she did, she switched providers. He was fed by ravens. And it says her cruse of oil and her barrel of wheat never ran out through the entire famine. You see, there is a blessing that generous people get that greedy people don't get. And that's supernatural provision that comes from heaven. When there is no visible source, God invents a source just for you. Turn to somebody and say, I want that unusual blessing to come on me. Tell everybody around you, I say, I want the ravens to start blessing me. I want the ravens to start feeding me. Look at somebody right now. Look at them and say, you're going to pay my house off on Monday to the glory of God. I'll give you the bank. We've had over 300 homes paid off now. It started about 3 years ago. The Holy Ghost told me, start speaking that over people. And homes are getting paid off by miraculous ways. I was preaching this. I told the pastor, God, somebody's going to pay your house off, Pastor. That next afternoon, Monday, he calls me up. He says, screaming, he says, you can't believe what happened. This man went into the bank, called me up, and he said, God told me to pay your house off. And he paid off that house. Over 300 times now. I wonder which one of you will be the one. Which one of you, I wonder which one has the faith to believe that somebody's going to pay your house off. Pastor, stood up. Is that all? Anybody else? Stand up if you believe that you're going to have your house paid off. You never know. I never know. I'm just doing it and throwing it out there. Be it unto you according to your faith. So I'm too embarrassed. I'm going to work my way through it. I'm just going to work like a man ought to work and pay my bill. Well, that's what you wanted to do it. I'd rather have you pay my house off. Look at six people and say, snap out of it. We then go to Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 30. A man is crippled. He can't walk. And he needs a blessing. So he has four good friends. It says they take him to Jesus. But they can't get to Jesus because there's thousands of people around Jesus and he's in a small house praying for somebody. So they say, we have to get our friend to Jesus. And they tear the roof off and throw him down there. And he comes out walking. But what is the secret of getting the blessing? Desperation. You see, a lot of Christians are not desperate for God. That's why some of you won't stand and say, I want to bring a Bible joke. Why? Because, well, it's a little bit too much trouble. I can remember everything. Really? Wow. You have a photographic memory. But this man said, no, I need help. And I'm desperate. Somebody take me to Jesus. If you can't get there on your own, make sure you got enough good friends that'll take you there themselves. Hallelujah. And that's called the house of God and revival time. Turn to two people and say, I need a personal revival. Say it out loud. I need somebody to tear the roof right off the house and just throw me on Jesus. Everybody said, I'm desperate enough that I need a move of God in my life. Like the Israelites after 430 years. Like the woman with the issue of blood. Like the man at the pool of Bethesda. Like the woman at the well. Desperate. So many people are not desperate. That's why they can just stay away from church and stay away from a walk with God. They believe in him, but they do not have a culture of him. A culture means you talk to God all day. It means before you do something, you ask permission. You don't just hit somebody in the mouth. You ask him first. May I knock this man out, oh Father? No? Ah, okay. I asked the Lord if I could knock you out, but he said no. Instead, he told me to give you an offering. Here's $100 for trying to kill me. See, some of you are going, this man's lost his mind. No, I'm just preaching a Bible type of Christianity, not a worldly type of Christianity. Because the worldly type won't get you anything. It's the Bible type that'll get you a blessing that nobody can steal from you. Hallelujah. Go ahead and hug somebody and say, you're getting saved. I can feel it. I'll give you one more. And this is powerful, very important. I want you to understand that we are planning moves of God for Monday night and Tuesday night. We're going to lay hands on you every night. We're going to flow in the Holy Spirit. We're going to flow right now. But I just want you to know that there are blessings coming towards you, not curses. There's a healing for your marriage. And those of you that are desperate enough, you're going to get that healing for your marriage. It's not that you're going to get divorced. Some of you might want to say that. Others of you are never going to do that. But you know you're living in a dry well. You need God to touch you in a beautiful way. This is my anniversary today. I've been married 47 years. 47 years. Pretty exciting. My wife is ministering to orphans in Guatemala. When she comes back, we're going to go out for some holla holla. So turn to two people and say, give me a high five. Juga, 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 juga. Turn to two people right now and simply say, you've needed this your whole life. Do you want to be blessed, ladies and gentlemen of the jury? Do you want to be blessed?
Yes.
We're going to have revival Monday night and Tuesday night. And you're going to have encounters with Almighty God. And it's going to revive your walk with God. And things are going to change in the house, in the home, in your family, in your business. And many of Satan's candy that you've been chewing on and eating. But please remember that whenever you eat Satan's candy, you have to pay his taxes. Nothing is free with Satan. You smoke a reefer, it's not free. You shoot up a little cocaine or a little heroin and then come to church and praise the Lord, that ain't free. He's going to make you pay from your soul. And you will pay because you gave him the authority to take it from you, and he will take it from you. He'll take your sleep first. Then he'll take other things. But the blessing of the Lord makes rich, and God adds no sorrow to it. Hallelujah. Put your hands on that person next to you and say, the blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. How do you get the blessing of God flowing and being released in your life and to other people? God has to breathe on you the breath of heaven. Genesis 2:7. He found Adam and made him out of the dirt, and then breathed in his nostrils the breath of life. John 20:22. Right before Jesus went up, he called the disciples, and it says he breathed on them the Spirit of God. All through the Bible, Song of Solomon 4:16, blow upon my garden, let the spices begin to flow out. And this is what God will do to you when you're in the house of God, worshiping with a sincere heart. He will blow his breath upon you and fill you up with the Holy Spirit. Say these words out loud. There will be no divorces in my family. None of my children will be atheists or agnostics. None of my children will be perverted. There will be no alcoholism in my home. No drug addiction in my home. None of us will be poor. All of our homes will be paid off. And we will pay other people's houses off. We will rescue orphans. We will take care of widows. We'll take care of the poor. And we will build the local church. There's a new building coming for Burleson. And that building is going to be paid off way ahead of time. It's going to be paid off because you're going to get so blessed that it's going to be easy for you to write a $100,000 check or a $1 million check. It will be easy for you because the blessing of the Lord is going to come pressed down, shaken together, and running over too. Everybody say, that's my kind of preaching right there. Turn to somebody and say, that's what I'm talking about. I need some of that kind of blessing. Come on. So, as we end our service this morning, I just want to bless people and flow in the Spirit of God. But if you're married and in this section, would you stand up? If you're married and in this section, would you stand up? Stretch your hands out to this couple in the front, and let me give you this word from the Lord. As the armies of Jehoshaphat went out, and they fought the armies of the enemy. There was 100,000 enemies and 30,000 of Jehoshaphat's soldiers. And then they looked up, and the heads of the enemies were rolling down the hill as the Lord made the enemy kill themselves. And then it took 3 days to gather all the spoil without fighting and without war. This means that you have 3 years of unbelievable blessings and spoil that the enemy took from your fathers, your grandfathers, your great-grandfathers, all the blessings they should have had, you are now going to get. Everybody say, I received that for myself. Woo! Everybody say, I received that for myself. Not you. Yep, stretch your hands out right here, this beautiful couple, right here. I hear this word. You are entering your 100-fold year. You sow a little, but you get back 100-fold. You will stay in this for the next 10 years. 100-fold, 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 100-fold in any area you decide in your time of prayer. Name the area, and God will give you the blessing. Praise the Lord. Everybody said, I received that for myself. How long have you been married?
Almost a year.
You got that shine on you. Got that shine on you. Praise the Lord. I hear this word, unconditional victory. This will be the sign over your family for the rest of your life. Satan can no longer hurt you, destroy you in any way. Unconditional victory is coming to your house. Unity of faith, unity of love, unity of vision, unity of purpose. What God has joined together, no man can destroy. Hallelujah. Let's all praise him a little bit and say, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. How long have you been married? And your guy's not here? He comes to church? Regularly? Stretch your hands out. So, what's his name?
Tim.
So, I just see a fire. I see a big fire. And the Lord says, I'm starting a fire in your house. It's going to go through every room till the entire house is lit up by God's presence and God's word. No extinguisher has been allowed in Satan's hands. Nothing bad is coming. The good is coming, not the bad. Praise the Lord. Let's go right here. Stretch your hands out. I see four blessings for you. I see a physical blessing on your bodies. I see a financial blessing from sources you did not expect. I see a family blessing you have not been praying for. And number four, I see a blessing of intimacy with God that God will give you, and you will have the Lord with you until the day you die, which will not be soon. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Tell me your name. Stretch your hands out there, everybody. Listen to this. It's really, really important. One, God loves you. Two, he hears your prayers. Three, get ready for an exciting year. Because four, it will be a year of unexpected breakthroughs. That's your word from God. You may be seated. Let's go to the next couple right there. How long have you guys been married?
9 years.
All right. Extend your hands out there. So first of all, 9 is the number of fruitfulness. How many kids do you all have? God bless you. 5 is the number of grace. But anyway, let's just keep going. No, that's this word is a beautiful word, but it's the power to stop tornadoes. Are destructive forces from hurting your family and all members of your family tree. Say to the devil who attacks members of your family, your family tree, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus and the storms will stop. You're going to see a very radical turning around of members of the family, extended members coming to God. Your family will be blessed all the days of your life. Do not believe the lies of Satan. God is removing them. Only good, for surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life, and you shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. All your children will be saved. They will all play musical instruments. All your children will love hunting. They will have high levels of education. And when you are old, they'll buy your house, buy your cars. You'll tell them no, they'll do it anyway. Because you're going to have great wealth from your children. You have four. There could be more. God bless America. Okay, you may be seated. Praise the Lord. How about you guys? How long have you been married? So the word I'm hearing very loud right now is unstoppable blessings are coming to your door. These are blessings that no one, no human being, no demon can stop. Because you have sown, the Lord says you're going to start reaping. You're entering the year of supernatural reaping, even of seeds that you have not sown. So from a dead ground, God will make fruit come up when there's not even seed in the ground, because this is the provision of heaven for you. Praise God. God bless you. Hallelujah. How about right here? Going a year and a half, 2 years. Praise the Lord. So everybody extend your hands right over there. I'm looking at the pool of Bethesda. And 38 years that man waited. Jesus went up to him and said, what do you want me to do? And he said, well you know, nobody helps me to get in the water to get healed. And God said, no, what do you want me to do? I'd like to walk. He said, okay, well, rise up and walk. And so the Lord says to you, ask me what you want me to do, and that's what I'll do. Everybody say, I receive that for myself. Come on, tell everybody around you, I'm receiving that for myself. Ooh, Jesus, Lamb of God, good word. Praise the Lord. So tell me about you, man. Oh, I like him. I like him right there. That man's got the Holy Ghost on him. But he didn't get it on his own, did he? That's right. And God says you're a hero in heaven. The angels know your name. Your prayers are like gold going up. And Satan will never, ever be comfortable in your home ever again. Hallelujah. Come on, everybody. Let's praise him a little bit and say hallelujah. I see the spirit of success on you. I see the spirit of faithfulness on you. I see the spirit of open-heartedness. I see the spirit of joy in you. I see the spirit of generational blessings on you that can be passed on and on and on. I see ministry inside of you of the laying on of hands and sick people getting healed and winning people to Jesus that are alcoholics, that are on drugs, that are rich, that are poor. I see the spirit of salvation upon you. I see the anointing of life over death on you. I see dead people getting raised from the dead. Even in hospitals, people that are dying, you touch them and miracles happen, and I see that you're entering your miracle ministry and your miracle life and your miracle anointing, and no one will be able to stop what the Lord is doing. You are like bulldozers just going over everything Satan has planted in people's lives and burying it forever, and you get the rewards of being faithful servants of the Lord. Everybody say hallelujah. I wish he had said that to me. Tell me your time of marriage. I see something. So everybody stretch your hands out. So no poverty from now on, no poverty. No poverty of any kind, no financial poverty. No soulish poverty of love, joy, and peace. No poverty of wisdom, no poverty of opportunity, no poverty of relevance, no poverty of success. All poverty is broken off you to four generations, and I sever that beginning this year, you will begin to prosper in 10 areas of your life like you have never been able to do before. God bless you. We'll go right over here. Stretch your hands, everybody over there. We pray, ma'am, for you to just have no fear of any kind of sickness coming upon you, that you just be able to sleep in peace and just have the joy of the Lord when you sleep. Beautiful dreams. I see a spirit of healing on your family, a spirit of wholeness, and a spirit of health. Whatever Satan has thrown against you, we all now gather together, and in the name of Jesus, we resist the devil and drive him away, so that when you look to the north, south, east, and west, you can say there is peace on all my borders. And that comes from the Lord. Hallelujah. Right here. How long have you guys been married? Almost how many years? 2 years. Okay. And you have that little beautiful bundle. Have you thought about how many children you're going to have? Yeah. I mean, you're never imprisoned to do anything. But I want to tell you that grace will be the word for you. That God will give you grace to know how big your quiver is, to be able to provide for your family and have the finances that you need. You're going to have a beautiful home. You're going to have property and land. God is going to do signs, wonders, and miracles. And all the people that disapprove don't know what they're talking about. Jesus is for you and with you, and everything is going to be all right. There are a lot of children around. I don't know. But no. One at a time. God bless you. Merry Christmas. Everybody, let's praise God a little bit. So we want the moving of the Holy Ghost. We want the Holy Ghost to move this week and minister to people. And so we'll do that on Monday. Put on my music. Close your eyes for just a moment. And every person, for the moment, think about your future. You will die, and no one knows when. You will die. You only have control over your eternal soul, which is the most valuable thing you own, is your soul. You're the only one that has control over that right now. They can control your body, but they can't get to your soul. You can do with your soul whatever you want. You can keep it from anybody. You can give it to somebody. You can do whatever you want. It's under your control. But on the day you die, your soul reverts to the Creator, and your free will is over. You have free will now. But you must be wise and smart to make sure to provide for your soul and your spirit in eternity. So my question to you is this: are you 100% sure that if you died today, you would go to heaven? Can you say, I have absolutely no doubt that if I died right now, at lunch, in my car, sleeping, that I would go to heaven? This is the question.
Let my children tell their children.
Do not take a chance on missing out on eternity.
Let this be their memory.
Do you want to go to heaven when you die?
That all my treasure.
And since no one but God can give you peace about heaven, He's the only one that can put that peace in your heart, so that when you go to bed or wake up, you know that you know that you know that if you died, you would go to heaven. Only God can do that. So my question, turn that down a bit. My question to you is this: are you ready for God to put that peace in you? I'm going to ask you to do something right where you're sitting that's very simple. If you want God to give you that peace right now, if you want Him to do that, all I want you to do right now is raise your hand right now, and I will pray for you. Lift your hand right this minute, and I'm going to pray for you. Lift it up high where God can see it. No shame, no embarrassment. Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me in public, then I'll be ashamed of you in front of my Father. But if you're not ashamed in public, then I'll be there on that day and confess your name to my Father. Wow. Look at all the people. Oh, my gosh. Lift those hands up and let everybody see that in heaven and on earth. If you are lifting your hand, I just want you to stand right there where you're at right now and let me pray for you. Would you stand to your feet right now? Thank you so much. Now, look at me for 1 minute. May I have your permission to lead you in a prayer? I will not make you say anything to anybody, but may I lead you in a prayer? If I have your permission, would you wave your hand at me? This is what I'd like you to do. Leave your chair and come up here. I won't make you talk to anybody. Come on up here and let me look at your face. Come on, give them a hand as they're coming. Come on up here. Give them a hand as they come up, because we're having revival starting right now, Monday night and Tuesday night, and we're believing God for a move of God. We're believing God for a move of God. What is more important than this event? What is more important? Everybody, the food is not going anywhere. The restaurants are not moving. Let's take a few minutes to celebrate with these people decisions that will alter their walk with God. I believe I'm hearing the Lord tell me there's four more individuals, keep playing that music, that need to come up. You did not raise your hand, but you are not sure that you're going to go to heaven. And you are here for this. This is why you're here. This is why you came here today. Because you're not sure, and God wants to put that in your spirit. He's the only one that can do it. There's at least four people. That's what I'm hearing. And I have done this for 52 years. I'm not practicing. I do this every week. I can hear the souls. The only way I can say it, I can hear them. If I have a testimony. If that's you, you know you. You know it. Your heart's beating very fast. You're going to have to make yourself get up and say, I need to make this right. If that's you, go ahead and do that right now. His faithful hand. And let God do what God has to do. Extend your hands. If you're one of those four people, you can get up at any moment. Your hands are stretched out. Let me say to you that are up here what is about to happen. Number one, God is about to forgive you for everything you have ever done in your entire life that makes you feel guilty or ashamed. And that is a big deal. That's a big deal. But God will do one more thing, something you need. When you leave here and you look up and you know God knows everything you've done, for some of you, it's going to be hard to talk to God like that. So here's what God does. He erases what you did from his memory. Literally, God no longer can remember what he forgave you for, because it is erased from his memory forever. And those are the two things that are just about to happen. I still feel those two souls. I'm giving you another chance. If that's you, you should come up right now. I can feel you. I can feel God reaching out to you right now. He's talking to you. You just need to get right with God. Let him do it. I'm just going to wait. Sometimes that door will close all of a sudden. I can't do it anymore. God is speaking to you. Thank you, buddy. All right. Let's all pray together. Dear God in heaven, forgive me for my sins and all the things I've done that I knew were wrong. I repent. I renounce Satan. I renounce his plans for my life. And I turn my back on him. And I run towards you. Will you wash me clean in your holy blood right now? Will you give me the power to serve you and live for you? Come and live in my heart, Jesus. And stay there for the rest of my life. I give my life to you. I forgive everyone that has damaged me, betrayed me, used me, abused me, and rejected me in my life. And today, I forgive myself. I allow myself to be freed, forgiven, and to start a new life. I cast my doubts away. And I say out loud, I'm going to heaven. Jesus is in my heart. My doubts have been erased. And I'm going to walk with God until the day I die. Would you turn around, ladies and gentlemen, and face the church? Don't sit down, just turn around. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, can I present to you these men and women and children that have been forgiven? They're on their way to heaven, and the devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. The devil is defeated. And I want you to celebrate them like your mother's up here, or your daddy's up here, or one of your children is up here. Because they are worth celebrating. In Jesus' name. God bless you all. Please be seated. Please be seated. The last thing I want to say, Pastor will be coming up here. He'll receive an offering. For those of you that know about our orphanage, I want to mention to you that we are building a brand new home for boys right now. We're laying the foundation. That's $12,000 for the first part of that. If you want to help us with that, that's how that works. You don't have to. You know, God blesses us here or there somewhere. He always manages to do it. We're building a vocational school that'll teach welding and electricity. The entire vocational school is already paid for. Someone just said, I will build it for you, the whole thing. That's how it works. Glory to God. Now I'm building a new house for boys. I need to get that foundation done, as I have a team coming in February. And if you're interested, $1 buys one meal. We're up to about 40,000 meals a month. So $1 pays for one meal for a child. So when you give, you know, $30, you're buying 30 meals. If you decide to be one of our partners, we'll tell you about that on Monday and Tuesday. Otherwise, to God be the glory. Here's Pastor Barry. Thank you, everybody. God bless you. I hope to see you on Monday.
Praise the Lord. What a morning. Amen. Man, I told you, I felt like it was bubbling up. I'm so happy for those of you that made decisions this morning. I love the way that, you know, God draws us, and we don't even know sometimes that he's drawing us, and we wind up in a place and we just respond. And then all of a sudden, everything changes in a moment. And for those of you that came up here, and there were a lot, those of you that came up here, listen, we want to partner with you. We've got Bibles and a Fresh Start book that we would love to give you. If you would like to take advantage of that, you can go right out here to Guest Central, and they will have
those bags with you just to give you real quickly. Please get that, because even as Brother Ivan said, you need the Word of God in your hands. You need to have something that you can begin to live your life by. And we live our lives by His precepts and His principles, and you can only find those through the Word of God. And so please let us partner with you in that. Also, Brother Ivan, we want to be a blessing to him. He's been a blessing to us, and he's going to continue to do that Monday and Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. But if you would like to give towards the orphanage or towards Ivan Tait, you can do that either online, heightslife.org, through Church Center app, or you can fill out an envelope, and there's boxes at the back that you can drop that in, and you can designate that What Matters Ministries or to Ivan Tait, and we'll make sure that that he gets that. But it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. So if you've been blessed today, then be a blessing to someone else. Also, I just feel led to tell you, as we go Monday and Tuesday night, there is a gifting that Brother Ivan has every time as an evangelist to win souls. And so maybe you came today, and maybe today was your day, and you said yes to Jesus. But you may be thinking about some friends that aren't here, some family members that aren't here with you today. Can I just encourage you, all of us, to invite some people to come back Monday and Tuesday night? I don't know where we'll fit them, but we'll fit them somewhere, okay? Crowd control is not a problem. In the story that he was talking about in the New Testament, they ripped the roof off because the crowd was too big. So I don't know if we're going to do that, but, you know, we'll make it work. So I just want to encourage you all to don't miss Monday and Tuesday. I feel like, you know, if you did get saved today, God wants to pour more into you. He's going to do more personal ministry, more one-on-one ministry Monday and Tuesday night. And so you just don't want to miss that. Would you stand with me today? Praise the Lord. Everybody say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Turn to your neighbor. No, I'm just kidding. Father, we thank you. We're so grateful for your presence. We're so grateful for who you are, the love that you give us. Lord, that even while we were yet sinners, you died for us, God. You love us. You're after us. Your love never fails. God, we thank you for that. Lord, thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for, God, the prophetic words that went out today, God. I pray that not one word falls on hard soil or soil that doesn't accept it. But, God, I pray that each word that went forth today, God, will perform that which it was sent forth to perform in Jesus' name. And, God, I speak over each person here today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless y'all.